Hey everyone, so I just want to preface this video by saying this is one of my favorite videos I've ever made. I think there's going to be a tremendous amount of value in this in regards to how you view the money system, building wealth, investing. And it kind of feels like, you know, a lot of people, like 99% of people are running around like chickens with their heads cut off, not really knowing like where or how to invest and sort of the theory behind it. And that's what I want to go into in this video. So it's not going to be like the basic concept of, you know, the 50-30-20 rule or put your money into index funds. I think a lot of us know that. We've heard that so many times. But I want to go into sort of like the mindset and understanding, you know, how to think about wealth building in a more like strategic sense. And so that's really the focus of this video. And there's going to be four primary like things that I always take into consideration when focusing on building wealth in any capacity. So let's go ahead. Let's jump into it right now. All right. So the first lesson, the first thing that I think is absolutely crucial, it's going to sound basic at first, but you're going to see exactly why this is so crucial in any time you're thinking about building wealth. And it's focusing on the concept of inputs and outputs. Okay, so to explain this point, we need to actually go over to physics and look at the first law of thermodynamics, which is the law of conservation of energy. And you're probably saying, what the hell is Nate talking about? I thought I was here to learn about money, not energy. But the law of conservation of energy essentially states that, you know, you can't, energy cannot be created or destroyed. It can be transferred, it can be transformed, but you can't create or destroy energy. And so I'll explain how this affects value and how you can view it the same way with the money system. So for example, let's say that the battery that I'm using for this camera right now. Hold on. All right, so this camera battery right here, right? So this, it's gonna run my camera, I can make this video, but where did the energy come from for this? It came from the wall. Where did that come from? Let's say it comes from a solar panel on top of the roof. Where does that energy come from? Comes from the sun, right? And so we're just transferring energy. We're transforming it into different ways, but it's essentially, you know, we're not able to just create energy from something. And so from the same way that you can view that, you have to look at that in the money system and in value in the same way. And so, for example, you can't just create value from nothing. So if you want to understand how wealth is created, you kind of just have to look at everything in the money system and in wealth as just units of value. And you can't just create value from nothing. Now, people are going to argue with that and they say, but I can create value from nothing. I can use my brain. I can start a business. No, you're transferring value from your brain or your hands, and you're using that. You're trading your time, and you're building a business. You're building something. And so there's always that transfer of value. And most things have a certain level of value, but you can measure it in everything as like in units of value. So real estate has value. People need to live there, right? Most businesses have value. People want to buy their products. And you as a person have value from an economic business standpoint. You have a certain amount of value per hour or per week or whatever work that you're putting in, the input and the output, you have a certain level of value that you're capable of providing. And maybe that's with your brain or with your hands. And so that's one way that it's like the most important first step of looking at it and breaking down business and business interactions and investing in that way of inputs and outputs and understanding you can't just get something out of absolutely nothing. Even ideas, that takes brain power. And so there's always an input and an output. Now, I know a lot of people are going to say the question, well, Nate, what about the Fed? What about central banks? I thought they can just print money. Aren't they just creating more value? The point's kind of messed up there, Nate. And the answer to that is no. So let me take out some money here. This is, all right, well, whatever, Polish money. And so let's say that the central bank of Poland wants to print more money. You know, you can say, oh, they're creating more value, but it's not true. They're just watering down. Let's say they make $1 trillion more and they pump it into the system. They're not creating more value. They're simply just watering down the amount of value that each bill is now worth. So it's just worth less. And that's kind of the point of that. So that kind of stands with the point of it's difficult to just pull value out of thin air. Now that we understand that, I think the biggest thing for this point here and the biggest question that you need to ask is, how can I accumulate more units of value? And there's a way to do this, and I'll share it later in the video. It's all kind of come together. But the question I always ask is, how can I accumulate more units of value? And I view everything in units of value. So that could be a very basic concept, but it's something that I use as like an overall overlying thing that I always look at in any business or investment is in units of value. All right, so let's talk about the second concept here that's absolutely crucial to understand, and that is leverage and scale. And I would say that this is probably what 99% of people this is the wall that they hit at some point. For some people, this is going to be when they get to $10,000. For most, it's probably going to be when they hit like $100,000 per year in revenue in their business or with their investments. And then anybody left from that usually hits the wall at around like $1 million or $2 million a year. But how do you push even further past that to make sure that you don't hit those walls? And the biggest thing to comprehend is leverage and scale and how you can use it to your advantage to make sure that you're able to grow faster than most other businesses, most other people in terms of wealth accumulation. And so there's kind of like a two-pronged approach here and the basics of it. And I'm trying to explain this as best as possible. I don't even have notes for this video. I'm just trying to, you know, dump my thoughts here for you. But basically, the thing that you need to think about here is that with leverage and scale, let's say that you have a certain capability of providing 40 hours of work per week or 50 hours of work per week. And I'll use a real world example here. So I have $80 right here, right? So I have $80. And from this $80, if I wanted to really focus on leverage and scale, what you would do in this case is you got to view it not just of like outsourcing, for example, and using leverage, but you got to look at it the way of, okay, let's say that I can take this $80 and I can pay somebody for 4 hours of work. I give them $20 an hour, 4 hours of work. And with that $80, their 4 hours of work is actually going to make $800 for me. Maybe let's say that I send them out and tell them, go write some blog articles, just a basic business model, right? Go write some blog articles. I make $800, I pay them 80. Now here's where it really gets interesting. Because from this, obviously I'm making a spread there, right? I'm making a spread, they're getting paid 80, I'm making 800. Maybe the market rate for that type of job is at $20 an hour. We'll talk about that as well because it's the capitalist society that we live in today. But this is how businesses operate. It doesn't mean you have to operate this way. But you have to understand that, you know, for the people who are going to get mad and say, Nate, well, you're underpaying this person, right? You're giving them $20 an hour. You should be giving them $200 an hour because that's how many units of value that that person is actually creating or that person is transferring. But the answer is no, that's not how it works because you have to realize that every business that hires somebody is planning on making a spread, basically making more money from when they hire them, from what they pay them versus how much they're making them. So, you know, if you have a job right now and you're making $50,000 per year, you're technically getting underpaid because that business is probably making $100,000 a year off of you or $200,000 a year off of you. So that's kind of the whole goal of a business in a capitalist world, at least, to make a spread on employees. Now, is that right? Is that morally right? That's not the point of this video. You know, you can make arguments for and against that, of course. But the point there is that making a spread, not just on other people's labor, making sure that you're paying them, you know, market rates, of course. I don't want this to sound like, you know, now this is coming out of my mouth, this sounds terrible, like I'm telling you to underpay people. No, certainly what we're talking about is paying market prices of whatever other jobs that you go out and get. But on top of that, you know, using that leverage and scale, right, from hiring people and outsourcing things, but also, so you're able to make a spread, that's one way that you can accumulate wealth, but then on the other side, you're saving time. So you're saving, how many hours is this, right? 4 hours of work, right? $80. So I'm saving 4 hours of my own time, and now I can go out and I can replicate this and make a spread on some other entity, on some other business, on some other person, right? And so that's kind of the concept of that, of using leverage and scale. And like I said, this is like the biggest problem that I think people run into, especially if you have a business. I actually saw this with a lot of YouTube friends as well. Like they really struggle to outsource it and to give people autonomy and freedom to do, you know, what they want. So let's say that you are going and paying somebody $80 for 4 hours of work. A lot of people, when they try to leverage, you know, use leverage and scale, they'll end up micromanaging this person and they'll always be there and they'll end up just kind of like not being able to outsource that time. And it's a big problem that a lot of people face. So that's another crucial lesson that you absolutely need if you want to scale to a certain level. Okay, so now that we understand both of those points, I want to introduce a sponsor for today's video. It fits so perfectly, and that is Wealthfront. So we don't always have a lot of time on our hands, and this is why I like using Wealthfront to help manage and invest my money. So here's what I really like about Wealthfront. It allows you to passively invest into the markets, which can not only save you time from trying to figure out what to invest into, but it can also help you to dollar cost average your investments into the markets in a very passive manner. So instead of trying to handpick stocks, you can let Wealthfront do the heavy lifting for you by diversifying your investments into asset classes of your choice based on your risk tolerance. And besides the easy to use interface, one of my favorite features of Wealthfront is their tax loss harvesting,
that they offer. So for a very minimal fee of just 0.25% annually and an account minimum of just $500, you can get started investing with Wealthfront. So if you take a look inside of the individual investment account, we can see how easy to use this platform is. They have lots of options. We can see our time-weighted returns, our dividends, our estimated taxes saved, and then we can look at our portfolio as a whole. And so if we go through here, we can click on recommendations. We can change this recommendation based off of our risk tolerance, you know, if we want more risk or less risk. And then we can also decide if we want to change the funds within it, and then we can add investments on there as well. So here's where it gets really cool. So Wealthfront just added hundreds of new investment options, so you have even more choices to build a portfolio that you're excited about. So for example, things like clean energy, socially responsible companies, companies in the healthcare sector, innovation and technology, cannabis, and even cryptocurrency. So I want to show you around some of these. For example, let's say that you wanted to have some exposure to some socially responsible companies. We can simply click on this and look through a variety of different socially responsible funds that are available. So maybe perhaps you're interested in looking at companies that are focused on clean energy. And we can click on this and we can simply add it to our portfolio if that's something that we would want exposure to. And I think one of the best things about Wealthfront recently is that they just launched crypto investments. So we can look at the ability to have exposure to cryptocurrency. And maybe you've heard a lot about cryptocurrencies in the news, but you don't really know how to get started. And getting this exposure through Wealthfront is going to be very easy to do. And so you're going to see two options available here, the Grayscale Ethereum Trust and the Grayscale Bitcoin Trust. And so if you wanted to add these to your portfolio, it's very easy clicking add to portfolio, and then you can choose the weighting on that. And overall, I would say it takes just a couple of minutes to set up. So Wealthfront is the only solution that offers a way to get exposure to Bitcoin and Ethereum as part of a diversified portfolio that also offers automatic rebalancing. So thank you, Wealthfront, for sponsoring this portion of the video. I will leave a link to them down below where you can get your first $5,000 managed for free. I personally use Wealthfront, and I think you might want to use them as well.
All right, so the next concept that I want to share with you is also very important, and that is understanding which part of the phase you are in a business cycle and an economic cycle, because there's four different primary phases. There's the stealth phase, the awareness phase, the mania phase, and the blow-off phase. And you really need to like understand this graph right here, because you know, typically, as a rule of thumb that I use, whenever you see something on the front page of CNBC and the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal, by the time you see it on the front page, it's already probably too late. And if it's not too late, you're at least not, certainly not in the stealth phase, and you're probably not in the awareness phase. You're probably most likely going to be in this next phase, which is going to get into the mania phase. And this doesn't even have to happen to a point of complete mania, like what we're in right now. We're obviously in a big bubble right now. You know, we have pictures of rocks selling for millions of dollars. I fully understand NFTs. I understand the crypto world. I've looked into it a lot, and I'm all for it. But we're getting ahead of ourselves a lot. And so you have to understand that, you know, we're not in the stealth phase. We're not in the awareness phase. And if you really want to build large amounts of wealth, this is the point that you want to be in. You want to be in one of these two, not in the latter half here, where everybody and their brother is going out and dumping their life savings into something. And even something like Bitcoin, although I do think it's the future, you know, probably most of the gains have been made, at least in the short run, at least in you know, this 12-month span here, most of the gains have already been made. And the smart people were the ones who got in much earlier. So how do you find those? How do you get in at the stealth phase, at the awareness phase? And I think the biggest thing is to just not follow the crowd, to basically go in the opposite direction of where everyone's going. So, for example, you know, a lot of people are now looking at some of the basic utility companies, right? So last year, back in January, February, March, I was looking heavily into a lot of companies that weren't in the tech industry. They didn't have 1,000 PEs. They were much more, you know, pumping at, you know, 7, 8, 9 PE ratio. And they were pumping cash and things that were utilities because I was worried about inflation, where everybody else was so focused on, you know, getting the next Dogecoin or getting the next Shiba Inu. There was a lot of people who made money off of that. But kind of just focusing on where other people aren't looking is I think, one of the best things you can do. And the best way to do that is to just make more connections, make more friends, ask people, you know, what are they doing? What are they interested in? Who's the smartest person that they know? And then get to know that person. And it can really take you a long way. Okay, so now let's talk about a concept that I use every day in my life when making decisions from a business and investing perspective, and that is opportunity cost. So I'll give you a couple of examples here. But basically, opportunity cost, the basics of it is that what is the next best thing that you could be doing with your time or with your resources? And you have to factor that into a cost. So for example, what is the opportunity cost of taking the bus rather than maybe taking an Uber? Well, if the bus takes an hour longer than the Uber, you have to factor in how much your time is worth. And if you're worth, say, $100 an hour, then maybe it's better off to take the Uber. Hopefully that makes sense there. I'll throw up a definition of opportunity cost right here in case I somewhat botched it. But that's the basics of it. Now, here's why it's really crucial to use, because I think the most important resource that we have is time. And it doesn't matter if you have $5 to your name or $5 million to your name. Time is the most crucial resource that we have. It's the most scarce resource that we have, and you can never get it back. You know, you can make $10 million and you can lose it all, and then you can make it back. But you can't do that with time. You can't make time and then lose it and then make time again. You just can't do that. And so valuing your time is going to be the most important thing that you could ever do. And so calculating that opportunity cost is something that I do every day with business and with investments. So there's a reason why I haven't really invested into many single family homes, because I don't have the time to do that right now. I don't have a business partner who can go out and do that. And if I go out and I try to invest into a single family home that's going to net me, say, like a 12% return on investment, then, you know, that might sound nice, but how many hours am I spending doing that? Finding that property, touring the properties, going out and, you know, trying to make connections in the real estate industry. I'm going to spread myself too thin. I'm going to spend hours, maybe hundreds of hours on that to get a 12% return, where I could maybe just take that money and put it into something else that maybe is going to take me half the time. So I love real estate, but that's one of the points there. You have to always factor that into every decision that you make. I'm good. Thanks for watching the video. Appreciate all the support, everybody. And I'll see everybody next week. Don't forget to check out Wealthfront down in the description below. Absolutely love them. Peace out.